بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله تعالى من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا. من يهده الله فلا مضل له، ومن يضلل فلا هادي له. وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن سيدنا ونبينا وحبيبنا محمدا عبده ورسوله، صلى الله عليه وعلى آله وصحبه ومن تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. أما بعد، فإن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله، وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها، وكل محدثة بدعة، وكل بدعة ضلالة، وكل ضلالة في النار. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته. This afternoon, we want to look briefly at the topic of az-zakah. And as we said, we want to keep it simple. So zakah made easy. Something that is relevant to all of us when it comes to zakah. I don't think we have farmers amongst us. Not many of us is probably going to find any treasures anytime soon. So I don't think we'll deal with those issues. But rather things that matter to us in our everyday lives that we experience. What are some issues pertaining to zakah? I'll try to keep it relatively brief, and perhaps there will be quite a few questions. I hope that I'm able to answer them throughout the talk, but if there are any questions, then inshallah ta'ala we'll answer them at the end. Let's begin with a few of the basics. What zakah is, how do we know that it's an obligation, and so on and so forth. As for az-zakah, then it is translated sometimes as a charity or an obligatory charity. And in reality, I guess we don't really have an English equivalent. But what we do need to realize is, whatever you're calling it, know this, that az-zakah, number one, is not voluntary. It is an obligation. And it is the right of others. Meaning, in our wealth, and we'll talk about how much of that wealth really counts. If you own a certain amount of wealth, then a portion of it does not belong to you. I mean, in essence, none of our wealth really belongs to us. Everything we have is an amana from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Although I wasn't going to say or speak on this issue, except let me mention it because of the fact that, you know, we have so many different forms of worship that all teach us something. They teach us the concept of al-ubudiyyah, or servitude. One thing that is for certain is that each and every one of us are the slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We are ibadullah, or ibadur rahman. The slaves of Allah, the slaves of the Most Merciful, subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, unlike what many say, for example, in non-Muslim countries, that you're free to do as you will. But we are not free, because we are slaves of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Therefore, our lives are governed by the laws laid down by Allah tabaraka wa ta'ala. Even the wealth that we earn, well, we earn it by the blessings of Allah Jalla wa Ala. He is the one who grants us the ability to earn, for example. And that wealth and that property that we have, we are not free to spend it as we wish. We are permitted to spend it in ways that are pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As for spending it in ways that are not pleasing to Allah, in haram, impermissible things, Sure, a person may do so, but they will be held accountable for that. It is breaking a law, the law of Allah Tabaraka wa Ta'ala. That wealth that we have to show us that really it doesn't belong to us, Allah would dictate what we can and what we cannot do with our wealth. As I said already, the issue of how we spend it. Because remember that Allah Jalla wa Ala will question us about it, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam told us, that none of us will move from our station before Allah Jalla wa Ala until we are asked about several things. Amongst those things, our wealth and our property. From where we have earned it and where we have spent it. Alright? So there you go. You're not free because you have to answer for it. You are going to be questioned about it by Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala. Look at something else. If you own a certain amount of property or more, then of that, a portion of that doesn't belong to you. We are told by Allah, there is a portion of your property that you have no right over whatsoever. It is a right of somebody else. One of the 8 categories of people that we will speak of, who are the recipients of zakah. So there are those who have an amount of wealth and property that is beyond what we call the nisab, a certain threshold that has to be reached. If you have beyond that amount, a certain portion of it doesn't even belong to you to begin with. And that's why you're not allowed to even delay giving it to those who are eligible to receive it. If you have wealth and property, when you die, people may do it, but it is haram, it is impermissible, that they write a will and they decide who receives what from their property after their death. Even after our death, we have no say except for what happens to up to a maximum of 1/3 of our property. See how we are slaves? We have a master, Allah Subhanahu wa Ta'ala, and we are obliged to follow the laws that He has laid down. So, before I die, I don't have the right to say all my wealth will go to my wife or a certain child of mine, alaykum assalam wa rahmatullah, or a certain amount goes to one child and a lesser amount goes to another. I don't have the right to do all of that. I'm told in the Quran and by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam that after I die, my wealth and my property will be divided amongst my heirs, and who are my heirs is also decided by Allah. That wealth and property will be decided amongst my heirs at a set rate or proportion. Allah has decided who will get a sixth, who will get a third, who will get a quarter, who will get an eighth, who will get a half of what I've left behind. And those individuals who are my heirs, who will inherit from me, I have no right before I die to say that some of them will get more than others. No, Allah has decided already. I cannot say, because this child of mine, you know, was a lot more kind to me. In my old age, this daughter of mine stood by me, and my good-for-nothing son did nothing for me. Huh? So I want her to receive double what he receives. I don't even have a right to do that. No, Allah has already decided. And because Allah knows what is in the hearts, and there are just so many factors that you and I are not aware of. Not only that, as I said, for those who are not our heirs, we cannot give any amount that we wish to them. So you cannot say, you know, as is done in many parts of the world, you know, the church will my kids were no good, you know, my wife was cruel, whatever the situation, I want everything to go to the church. Well, we cannot give it all to the masjid even, or an Islamic society. No, you're not allowed to do that. Only up to a maximum of 1/3 of your wealth can you, before you die, dictate where it will go, outside the heirs. So when it comes to our wealth and our property, it should be well understood that we are not free to spend it and do with it as we wish. It has to be within the confines of the Sharia. So coming to the zakah, it is a right that others have over our wealth and our property. That's why we call it, I prefer to call it the poor due, as opposed to, you know, just charity. Alright? So, az-zakah then Let's begin by reminding ourselves that it is one of the fara'id of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, one of those things which Allah jalla wa ala has made an obligation upon His believing slaves. And it is the third pillar of Islam after the shahadatain and after the salah, which shows you the status of az-zakah. Its obligation is proven through the Qur'an, وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةِ, I mean many ayat in the Qur'an, through the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the famous hadith being بُنِيَ الْإِسْلَامُ عَلَىٰ خَمْسِ, Islam is built upon five things, and he mentions the pillars of Islam, one of them is the zakah, and there is an ijma', in other words, a consensus amongst the Muslims that az-zakah is an obligation upon the believer, if certain conditions are met. And we will speak about those in a short while, bi-idhnillahi subhanahu wa ta'ala. To understand the meaning of zakah, we can also look at some of the linguistic meaning so we can see where the sharia meaning comes from, or where the technical meaning comes from. Zakah zar'u. So when they talk about crops, zakah zar'u means that those crops increase or they grow. They increase. Zaka shay'u also refers to an increase. Okay, so zaka takes its name, as zakatu takes its name from that verb, zaka yazku, for example, because an individual's wealth grows by giving the zakah, which sounds strange to some people. I'm giving my property, I'm giving of my wealth, how does that increase it? But there are many people who don't understand that it's about barakah. There's also an issue called al-barakah, or blessings that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places in an individual's wealth. We also should understand, as the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told us, that an individual's wealth will not diminish. It will not decrease through giving charity. Now, we'll speak in just a short while to remove some confusion in the minds of some about the difference between az-zakah and as-sadaqah. Az-zakah, what we're speaking of now, and as-sadaqah, which we know as charity. Okay, we'll speak about that in a short while. But the word as-sadaqah is also used for zakah, and you will understand whether it's zakah or not by the context. Okay, so az-zakah is a type of sadaqah. Anyway, we'll come to that in a short while. The Prophet ﷺ told us that no wealth will be diminished, it will not be decreased through a sadaqah. You give charity, you pay zakah, it will not diminish your wealth. Ultimately, it will bring growth to your wealth. Okay, so this is one of the reasons it is given that name. As well, because it acts as a purifier. So, they say, for example, in the Arabic language, zaka shay'u, okay, because it refers to improving something, sanctifying something, rectifying something. And so you find al-abdu salih, okay, al-abdu salih, when we talk about as-salah, we are referring to that individual who is righteous. In other words, that individual who is obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and far from sin. So that person is purified. Okay? أَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا زَكِيَّةً in Surah Al-Kahf. When Musa alayhi salam asks Al-Khadir, أَقَتَلْتَ نَفْسًا زَكِيَّةً from the same root, zakah. So we're speaking here of a pure soul. And of course we're speaking of a child. And what is the default of position when it comes to children? That they are free of sin. So they have pure souls. So we're talking about the issue of purification. So az-zakah also denotes at-tahara, or purification and keenness to do good and refrain and abstain from filth and that which is disgraceful. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Quran, if we look at قَدْ أَفْلَحَ مَنْ زَكَّاهَا, okay, so he has succeeded who purifies it. Purifies what? Purifies his or her soul. How does one purify his or her soul? By remaining obedient to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and being righteous. So these are some of the linguistic meanings of zakah. And of course, as we said, the technical meaning or the shari'i meaning is taken from that. Okay, so the obligation of az-zakah takes its name from these particular meanings, or some of these meanings that I have given you, because through zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifies our wealth. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala purifies the souls of the givers of the zakah, and also the recipients of the zakah. The one who is giving, yes, their souls are purified of qualities such as stinginess and greed. And the souls of the recipients are purified of things such as jealousy and hatred towards the wealthy, for example. When we look at az-zakah, an individual is, of course, to give it willingly. And a person who gives their zakah willingly, knowing that it is a command from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is an individual who will rise above their wealth. What does that mean? It means that such an individual who gives, an individual who is not a hoarder, a person who gives, is an individual who owns their wealth and is not a prisoner to their wealth. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to purify our souls so that we will realize the value of that wealth, the real value of that wealth, and so that we will not become so attached to that wealth to the extent that we become prisoners to that wealth. Look at those whose primary concern is to hoard wealth. Subhanallah. Some of them, they may have a great deal of wealth, but their love for it is so strong that even in times of need, they are not willing to spend their wealth for their own well-being. They will not spend even on their families. So if a family member requires medical attention, oh, that's too expensive. I mean, you have hundreds of thousands, but this is going to cost 10,000, but it's very expensive. Can't afford that. What do you mean you can't afford it? It's just the love of wealth that that individual may have. Alright, az-zakah, it is an obligation, meaning that a Muslim who is in a position where they have a certain amount of wealth and it is in their possession for a certain period of time, as I said, we'll talk about all of those things in a short while, if that individual now on whom zakah is due, it is an obligation, does not give zakah, what is the hukum, what is the ruling on that individual? Let's come back and remind ourselves that we are slaves, and when we say that something is fard, it means it is not a matter of choice. And the reason I want to hit hard on this is that we live in a day and age where people say you're free to do as you wish. Faith is in the heart. Faith is not something you can impose on others. No, Allah has imposed things on us. The salah is an obligation. Allah has imposed it on us. If you do not pray, offer those salawat, those five daily prayers, for example, there are consequences, which means that it is imposed on you. So it is an obligation, meaning that you don't have a choice in the matter. The same thing with zakah, any of these faraid. Remember, when we say something is wajib or fard, it means you don't have a choice. By not doing it, you are exposing yourself to the punishment and the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If He wills, He will punish you, and He will be justified in doing so. And if He wills, through His mercy, He subhanahu wa ta'ala can forgive you. Okay, so when it comes to zakah, if a person refuses to pay, well, it may be due to one of two reasons. The first is that they deny that zakah is an obligation. And a denier of zakah, well, it may be that the person is aware of it, but they are being arrogant. No, why should I have to pay zakah? It's my hard-earned money, and so on and so forth. So they're saying that, no, it's a matter of choice. And again, this is very significant, especially in our day and age, where there are people who will tell you that prayer is a choice. Paying zakah is a matter of choice. I don't have to do it. No, As long as you are aware, in the Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made it a binding obligation. Through the authentic sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you know beyond the shadow of a doubt that it is an obligation. Okay, you have knowledge of it now. The proof has been established. You know that it is an obligation, but out of arrogance you're saying no. But I see it another way. But who are you to see it another way? Allah has already made it clear. The ummah, the Muslims have agreed upon it. So an individual who denies zakah based on this knowledge is considered to be a kafir, one who has left the fold of al-Islam. As simple as that. Then there are those who may deny it out of ignorance. They're not aware. Let's take, for the sake of an example, an individual who has come newly to Islam. There are people who come, they're fresh. They don't know too much about Islam. They came to Islam because of some wonderful things they learned and so on and so forth. They were told about prayer and they started to pray because, you know, prayer, naturally people are inclined towards it. But you know, when it comes to money, it's a sensitive issue. A certain percentage of your wealth you have to give annually. Wow, the person may say, hang on a second, I didn't sign up for that. This can be one of the pillars of Islam. If the person denies in that way, we can't say, oh, now you're not a Muslim any longer. No, they're not aware. They don't have the knowledge. And so they are to be educated, and they are to be taught, and time is to be taken. And then at the end, and when I say at the end, not at the end of our 5-minute conversation, after establishing the proofs and so on and so forth, then if they were to deny, then that is another story, and they fall under the first category. Those who refuse to pay the zakah out of stinginess, this is the second one now, so the deniers is the first. Now there are those who acknowledge that zakah is an obligation, but they're just too attached to their wealth and their property. These are people that we cannot call kafir, because they acknowledge that it is an obligation, but they're just too attached to their wealth, they're too stingy, and they are not giving it up. For them, you look to the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. Now, I mean, I think these are things that most of us are well aware of, so I don't want to take too much time looking into all of those texts. But you have texts in the Quran and the Sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam in which we are told about certain punishments. Yeah? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks of those who hoard gold and silver. يَكْنِزُونَ الذَّهَبَ وَالْفِضَّةِ. What will happen to them? And how they will be punished with that property of theirs in the hereafter. The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam informs us of something similar, and he informs us even those who have zakah due on their livestock, they will be punished through their own livestock in the hereafter, by that livestock trampling over them and gorging them and so on and so forth. Okay? So, if a person is too stingy and not giving the zakah, we're not going to call them a kafir for that, because they have not denied its obligation, but they have certainly exposed themselves to the wrath and the punishment of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. They have committed a crime. If they are in a purely Islamic state, then again, I mean, we're not going to go into those details, but in that case, the Khalifa, the ruler, has a right to take that property from that individual forcefully. And people may think it sounds, oh wow. Well, what are you talking about? Did you know that in man, according to man-made laws, if you don't pay your taxes, you are forced to pay them? If you're living in the United States, the IRS, if you live in Canada, Canada Revenue Agency, I don't know, what do they call it here, whatever revenue agency you probably have here as well, they'll come after you. They will seize your property, correct or not? So don't think that it's, oh, you know, how come Islam is so harsh? What harshness are you talking about? It's okay when it's a man-made law, but it's not okay when it's a divine law, that which comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Yes, the hakim, the ruler, oh, your prime minister, the president of a certain country, and his government, they decide on these policies, is it not? Well, this policy that we are speaking of with regards to zakah has been sent to us from above the seven heavens, from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the leader is empowered with that. He may forcefully take that person's property, just like your revenue service or your revenue agency takes it from the citizens of a country. And the reason I mention this again is because people have these dreamy ideas. That when it comes to the way Islam deals with things, it's very harsh. But when it comes to the way that people deal with it in their man-made laws, oh, that's okay. They're willing to accept and acknowledge those things. SubhanAllah, how come? Oh, this is forced religion. Oh, what is that then? Forced religion also. It's called democracy. It's just another religion. You know, so we need to be realistic about these things. Don't think it's harsh. Well, how can you say that they can force it? In any, practically any nation, they do so. These are laws. I mean, this is the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You owe this. It doesn't belong to you. So the ruler has the authority to take it from you. It doesn't belong to you. And to pass it on to those who deserve it. And that is their God-given right. It is their God-given right, not their constitutional right. You're okay when we say constitutional right, but you have a problem with it when we say a God-given right. Allahu musta'an. Tayyib. Moving on, when it comes to the issue of zakah, what's the benefit of it? I mean, why should we be giving a zakah? Who are the beneficiaries? The reality is that the individual who pays the zakah benefits, the recipients of the zakah benefit, and society at large benefits as well. As for the individual who is paying the zakah, before anything else, it is that this individual is submitting to the will of Allah. This is part of their Islam. That they are fulfilling one of their rights towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is an obligation that has been placed on us by Allah. So we are fulfilling that. This is an act of obedience to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. By paying the zakah, we are drawing closer to Allah jalla sha'nuh, because we have fulfilled that obligation. And the beauty is that when we fulfill any obligation towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we are also rewarded for it in this world or in the hereafter or in both. That is the beauty. When we pray to Allah jalla wa ala, we benefit in many ways. And one of those benefits is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward us. What good will that reward do us? Of course, we benefit from it in the akhirah. وَلِلَّهِ الْمَثَلُ الْأَعْلَى. You know how people have reward cards from, I don't know, the Loaf and Parkson and wherever else it may be. Why do you collect those points? Because in the end there's a big payoff. Well, our big payoff is the akhirah, the hereafter, before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the first benefit to the payer of zakah, as we said, is that the individual is fulfilling an obligation, and so they have averted a punishment and they have earned reward from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through that act of obedience. Another benefit is that it increases that individual's faith or certainty of faith in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Meaning what? Meaning that you have a good opinion of Allah. You, when you pay your zakah, you know that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will compensate you for it. When we pay zakah, if you understand what zakah is, you will not see it as a tax where you are being burdened and where it is diminishing your property and your wealth. Rather, you will understand that, wow, this I'm giving for the sake of Allah, and I am fully confident, and I know for a fact that Allah will replace it with that which is better. In this world, as well as the hereafter, bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. We mentioned one of the other clear-cut benefits, and that is how it purifies the soul of the giver, purifies it of those qualities such as stinginess and greed. Okay. And through it, that is through paying the zakah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala causes an individual's wealth to grow and to increase. Again, no one's property will be diminished by paying any type of charity or zakah. How will that increase come about? This is important to people because, you know, it's my money. it's in my possession and I have to give it away. How is that going to bring an increase to me? The reality is, the increase that comes our way could be practical. I mean, literally, you will make more money as a result of it, or it could be spiritual in nature, meaning that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless that wealth. How is it that it could increase practically? Well, it could be because of that obedience towards Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When we actually pay our zakah, then Allah jalla wa ala will cause an individual to get a raise, a promotion at work, as a result of this act of obedience. A person who is in business, Allah jalla wa ala might cause their profits to increase. Yes, this practically happens. And at the very least, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places barakah, blessings in a person's wealth. That is a topic all on its own. One day we have to talk about barakah. And what does al-barakah mean? Barakah means that Allah jalla wa ala increases the good in what you have. Okay? So, although you may have a small amount of money compared to another individual, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala places barakah in it, it means He causes it to go a long way. It means you benefit from it a lot more than others may. Look, people whose wealth and property is devoid of barakah, subhanAllah, it's a huge calamity. And by the way, it is the first consequence of earning through haram means. If your wealth and property is haram, the first thing that will happen is that it will be devoid of barakah. A person may have a lot, but subhanAllah, Allah Jalla wa'ala will cause that person to always fear poverty. Allah Jalla wa'ala will cause that wealth to be used up very quickly. Perhaps that individual's family members will squander that property away. Perhaps Allah Jalla wa'ala will send calamities in the direction of that person, so they have to spend. Accidents, medical bills, whatever it may be. So there's no barakah in it. As for the individual who gives zakah, Allah Jalla wa'ala protects their wealth, and He subhanahu wa ta'ala places barakah in it. So it will be increased, either practically speaking, or at least, as we said, spiritually, if you want to call it that, and that is through placing barakah in a person's wealth. And this is why you find people who give the zakah, you know, with pure souls, who give the zakah willingly and not grudgingly, subhanAllah, they're always in a good condition. Their state is always good because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is with them. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala preserves and protects their wealth for them. Okay? What I think we want to say in with respect to this is, it is not important how much we have. What is important is how much barakah, how much Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses our wealth. Some people feel blessed because they have children. So you would think the more children you have, the more blessed you are. But what about those who have 9 or 10 children and none of their children care about them? Where is the barakah in that person's children? Whereas there may be an individual who is not blessed with many children, or not granted many children, I should say. But even with that one child, whether it be a male or a female, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put barakah in that child. Allah jalla wa ala put goodness in that child. So that child was with you through thick and thin. That child stands by you. That child is obedient towards you, and so on and so forth. So it's not the number that matters at the end. The one with 9 or 10 children, all of whom abandoned him or her, what good were those children to him or her? Whereas that individual with just one child is blessed because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put barakah in that child for them. Let's move on then to the issue of the benefits to the recipients. So we spoke briefly on how the payer or the giver of zakah benefits. What about those who receive? Well, there's an obvious benefit. They happen to be poor and needy, as an example, and by them receiving the zakah, what is happening? some of the stress that they are going through, some of the you know, the need that they have is being met. They're being relieved of some difficulties in their lives by receiving that zakah. As we said earlier, even the recipient's soul is being purified through this. What is happening? What is happening is that that individual will no longer have hatred towards those who are more wealthy. You know, those who are wealthy and they're stingy, how do people look at them? Not very nicely. The poor and the needy look at them and think that, wow, you know, how greedy are you? How selfish are you? But if the wealthy give to the poor and the needy, subhanAllah, it will change their hearts. They will actually have love towards the wealthy, and they will pray for them. You know how many homes, alhamdulillah, look at how many homes are run or supported through sadaqah or through zakah, you know, from the kindness of those who are wealthy. And as a result of that, perhaps their wealth is being preserved because those individuals are so grateful that when you don't even realize it, sometime in the day or night, they are raising their hands before Allah Jalla wa'ala and praying for you because you have supported them, because you have given them. So their souls are being purified, and they don't feel, you know, they don't feel as though they are being oppressed. They don't feel as though they are being neglected. As well, it averts thoughts of haram. In other words, if a person is so poor, you know, they're suffering in poverty, when they become desperate, what might happen? It may be that they will think of doing something haram, unlawful, in order to survive, right? They may have to steal, they may have to swindle, they will do something, take the property of others, and in an unlawful manner. But if the zakah is given to them, then they benefit in that they won't even think about doing that which is haram. And of course, it benefits the society because it bridges the gap between the rich and the poor. This is clear. When you start giving, alhamdulillah, then you don't... I mean, yes, let's get one thing straight, and that is these classes of rich and poor, they will always exist. There's no running away from that. This is how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has willed that it will be amongst His creation. There will be those who are poor, there will be those who are, you know, as we call the middle class, there are those who are going to be rich, and all of them are being tested in some way, shape, or form. Those who are wealthy, of course, the test is, how will you treat those who are less fortunate? How will you deal with that property that you have been given and entrusted with by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? As for the poor, they will be tested as well. How patient are you? And how tolerant and how patient will you be of abuse that you might receive from those who are more fortunate than you? So it's all about a test. So those classes will always exist. Huh? But it is good for the society because, of course, as we know, that if you provide for those who are less fortunate in your society, what will happen? It will reduce crime, will it not? It will create better relations between the rich and the poor. The poor will not be after the property of the rich. They'll be pleased with it. Alhamdulillah, this is a blessing they receive from Allah. As long as they're sharing with us, why should we want what is in their hands, what they have earned themselves, alhamdulillah, not a problem. So it reduces crime and help. So the whole thing of poverty in any society, if this law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if this obligation is fulfilled, you will see that poverty will be eradicated. Will there be poor and less fortunate people? Yes. But at least their basic needs will be met. Think about it today. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has blessed the vast majority of us. And then there are those who cannot even meet their basic needs. If every single Muslim, and let's be very frank and very practical, if every single Muslim on the face of the earth were to give zakah, as they are obliged to give, do you honestly think that there will be a poor person around? What? There would be no poverty because everybody is giving and the recipients are receiving. Those who are less fortunate are receiving. their share of property which is in the hands of others. But the problem is, not everybody is giving. And another problem is, some are giving, but they are not being very diligent. And so, perhaps that wealth goes to people who are not deserving. In any event, there are many, many benefits, as we said, to zakah. There are many hikam or wisdoms behind them. We have mentioned only a few of them. Sometimes I don't know what I should mention and what I should leave. Again, we want to simplify zakah. Let's come to now the conditions of obligation for zakah. Is it each and every individual that has to pay zakah? Obviously not, because there are those who have to pay and there are those who are eligible recipients. So let's start with, who are those people who must pay zakah? What conditions must be met before zakah is due on a person? Okay? So now, you and I, when we hear these conditions, we will learn whether or not zakah is due on us. And when I say on us, on our property, because it is a haqq or a right on our property. First and foremost, the person must be a Muslim. Meaning that zakah is not an obligation upon non-Muslims. How is this significant? Of course it's significant. Let's say that you have a state and it is being run according to the Sharia. The ruler cannot impose zakah on the non-Muslim citizens, because zakah is an obligation only upon Muslims. Remember the hadith of Mu'adh ibn Jabal radiyallahu anhu warda, in which he was sent by the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to al-Yaman. What did he tell him to do? He said, first you call them towards La ilaha illallah. فَإِنْهُمْ أَطَاعُوكَ فِي ذَلِكَ. Once they accept that, in other words, once they enter Islam, فَأَخْبِرْهُمْ, then inform them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated 5 daily prayers on them. Then inform them that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has obligated them to pay the zakah. A certain amount will be taken from the wealthy amongst you and given to the poor amongst you. Right? So, but the first step is al-Islam. So, al-zakah is something that cannot be imposed upon non-Muslims. It can only, zakah is only acceptable from a Muslim. The same thing with all the other fara'id. So you have a non-Muslim, if they pray with us the salah, let's say they go through the motions, their salah is not valid, it's not accepted. They've gone through motions only, and they have no value whatsoever with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because deeds will not be accepted until the person has come to al-Islam. The same thing with fasting. People think, oh, it's a good thing, you know, we get the non-Muslims to fast. All they get out of it is hunger and thirst. If that's the exercise you want for them, okay, I guess. Spiritually, they gain nothing from it whatsoever. And by that, I mean, in terms of rewards from Allah Jalla wa'ala, because it's not accepted from them. As-salah, as-siyam, as-zakah, hajj, none of these things are an obligation upon non-Muslims. They cannot be forced to fast, for example, or to pay the zakah. Alright, so al-Islam is the first one. The second one, that the individual has to be free. Okay, I mean, maybe not so relevant to us, but in the odd cases we still have in the world today, where there is slavery, Muslim slaves, for example, right? The slave and everything he or she owns is the property of the master. So, the zakah is due on the master, not on the slave. But alhamdulillah, all of us are free, so that condition, of course, is met by all of us. The first two, we meet those conditions. We are Muslims, and alhamdulillah, we are free. The third one, so now that, okay, we're Muslim, we're free, we're not slaves, except to Allah Azza wa Jal, in order for zakah to be an obligation upon an individual, they must possess the nisab. The nisab is the minimum, or if you want to call it the threshold value, that has to be in the possession of an individual before zakah is due on their wealth. If a person is just surviving month to month, in other words, by the end of the month, you got nothing. You're living from paycheck to paycheck, as they say. Correct? So you have literally no savings, or a minimal amount of savings. Then zakah is not due. What is that nisab? Let's just mention it now quickly. The nisab. none of you are farmers, I don't have to worry. Right? But we are people who will own gold or silver, or that which takes the place of gold or silver, what we call cash today. Right? Or you may own trade goods, something that you have purchased, which is for resale. You're a shopkeeper, the stock that you have. You like to buy and sell cars, that car that you bought with the intention of flipping it, of reselling it. Okay? So on these trade goods, and on gold and silver and cash, what is the nisab? The nisab on gold, let's look at them separately. The nisab on gold is the equivalent today of 85 grams of gold. So if you have in your possession 85 grams of gold or more, whatever form it is in, you have it in bricks, you have it in chips, you have it in the form of jewelry, yes, jewelry. I know it's an issue which there's a difference of opinion among the ulama whether you use it or not, but we will go with the opinion that whether your jewelry is for personal use or not, zakah is due on it. If you are convinced of the other view, of course, I'm not going to say you have to follow my opinion. But what appears to be the most correct opinion, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows best, is that gold and silver jewelry, even if it is being used, zakah is due on it. This is the opinion of the Hanafis, and it seems to be the most valid one, not because the Hanafi said it, but because of the evidence in the Sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, where we have examples of that young girl who was wearing two bracelets of gold. And the Prophet ﷺ asked, she was wearing them. So was that her savings? No, she was wearing them, using them as jewelry, as adornment. And the Prophet ﷺ asked if zakah was being paid on them. Or would she rather that they become two rings of fire for her on the day of judgment? Right? This is from amongst the strongest of evidences when it comes to that. Both sides have their evidence, but when we weigh it, it seems, Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, Allah knows best, that zakah is due even on jewelry that is being used. Okay, so if you have gold in any form that reaches 85 grams or more, then zakah is due on that gold. If you have 50, you don't have much jewelry, or you don't have much gold, it's less than the 85 grams, then there's no zakah due on that gold. But if you have 85 grams or more, okay, know that zakah is due. Okay? Silver, same thing, except that it is in the neighborhood of 600 grams. To be a little bit more accurate, I believe it is 595 grams of silver. If you possess that amount of silver or more, zakah is due on it, otherwise there is no zakah due on it. Clear? Alright. What about your cash? How many grams of cash? You don't count it in grams. Because cash has taken the place of gold and silver. So we look at its value. It's a tough one in the sense that nowadays, you see the huge disparity between the value of gold and silver. I mean, 595 grams of silver and 85 grams of gold. I mean, there's a huge difference in the value. I checked it just last week, and the numbers have flown out of my memory. But anyways, it's very easy to Google it. You can find the value of 1 gram of gold and the value of 1 gram of silver. You do the math. 595 times that, 85 times that, and it's a huge difference. There are those who will tell you that you take the highest of the two values. And there are those who will tell you to take the lowest of the two values. Obviously, the safest bet is to go with what? The lowest of the two values. Unless that value is so ridiculously low that it doesn't even make sense. Let's say for the sake of argument, you know, there was a time when gold, the silver was ridiculously devalued. It was super cheap. You know, maybe 595 grams of gold wouldn't have cost you $20. You know, I mean, a very small amount. And I mean, you know, even poor people may have that amount of money in the societies that we live in. Okay, but I recall doing the math last week sometime. So my strong recommendation would be use silver as the bar. Okay, so 595 grams of silver is equal to, I'm going to throw out numbers. Don't take these numbers as, you know, as gospel. Say it's worth $350 today, just for the sake of argument. Then the nisab will be $350. If you have $350 in your possession, over and above your basic needs, in your savings, now you have to start thinking, oh, I'm going to have to pay, I may have to pay zakah. I may have to pay zakah. So the minimum amount of wealth that is zakatable is, today in cash, the worth of 595 grams of gold, silver, I'm sorry. 595 grams of silver. Okay? If you're looking at them separately as gold and silver, 85 grams of gold or 595 grams of silver. Some of the other details, let's leave them for a little bit later. Three conditions so far. Al-Islam, that you're free, not a slave. Number three, that you must possess the nisab, that minimum value that the Sharia has laid down. But still, zakah may not be compulsory upon you, because that minimum value, the next condition, which is the fourth condition, is that one hawl has to pass. By hawl we mean one hijri year. So that amount, that minimum amount, should have been in your possession for one full year. That minimum amount or more. So let's say, for example, you have $500. Again, I'm throwing out numbers just for examples. And the nisab happens to be 350. Yesterday, you didn't have much. You had maybe a couple hundred, $200. Okay, let's say, for the sake of argument. And subhanAllah, today, you sold something and all of a sudden you find yourself with $500. Immediately you should say, the nisab is 350, so now I have 500. I have to start counting. So you record. On such and such a date, I have hit the nisab. So I passed the 350 mark. I have 500 with me. Now, what do? I wait for one Islamic calendar year. We are Muslims, so we base everything on the Islamic calendar. So, I don't say it's the 13th of July, for example. No, I will talk about the 15th of Ramadan. 14th of Ramadan next year? Now I see how much I have. Well, I'm back down to 200 bucks. Is there any zakah on me? No. I'm up to 1,000. Is there any zakah on me? Yes. Because at the end of that hawl, that one Islamic calendar year, I have above the nisab. So that full amount, I owe zakah on it. Is that clear? A question will arise though. What if in between, I dipped below the nisab? Possible or not? You have 500 today, and then you end up spending and you're down to like 100 bucks. Or maybe you had nothing. Allah forbid your car broke down. So you had to pay everything to get your car fixed. You got no savings at all. You got nothing. You got to wait for the next paycheck. Or maybe you have to borrow until the next paycheck. Does it happen or not? Real life, it happens. What do we say? According to some. If I'm not mistaken, the Hanafi madhab, they say you look at the two ends of the year only. Don't worry about what happens in between. It may be a safe opinion to take, but is it the strongest of opinions? Allahu A'lam, no. The strongest opinion seems to be that of the majority. And they say that, let's say, you do reach the nisab. You have the nisab or more. In our example, nisab is 350, you have 500. So you start counting from the date that you know you have reached the nisab. Whatever date that may be. It does not have to be in Ramadan. Let me come to that a bit later. Okay, before the year is up, in between you dip below the nisab. The strongest opinion, and it is also the opinion of the majority, wallahu a'lam, is that the moment you go below the nisab, you stop counting. When it comes above the nisab again, then you say, okay, now I have to see if it'll last me a year or not. Is that clear? And you know what? There are many people, the average person, may be in that situation. Not everybody has a bank account and savings and so on. Some really live paycheck to paycheck. And they may not be able to save much. If they save $50, it's a big deal. So for them, it is significant. Because if they look at the two ends of the year, maybe most of the year they didn't even have the nisab. Just because they had the nisab at one point. Now, a year later, so happens that it fell on payday. I mean, you know, wow. Now I got to pay zakah on the whole amount. Right? It can be, I mean, I don't want to use the word, but, you know, in a sense, almost unfair to them. Right? So the Sharia looks at, no, it should be in your possession. If you went below, if you dipped below the nisab, don't worry about it any longer. Once you have the nisab, if that lasts you for a year, alhamdulillah, then you owe zakah on that. So we have Islam, freedom, that you must possess the nisab, the minimum amounts laid down by the Sharia, that 1 year had to pass. Another one is, you must have complete ownership of that property. That you are free to do with it as you wish. I mean, the example I gave earlier of the slave. The slave might have money, but, you know, and they're trying to buy their freedom, for example. They have a deal with their owner, that they're going to buy their freedom. So although they have that savings, so to speak, but how are they going to pay zakah on it? They don't pay zakah on it because they're not free to use it as they wish. This is now going towards a payment, ransoming themselves, if you will. Okay, so you must have complete ownership of it. I guess examples that we have today are when, let's say your pension. Right? Is it a real example or not? You have something called a pension. Do you have access to that pension? You don't have access to it. You can't say to your boss or to the government, I want whatever is due to me in my pension. You haven't reached that age that they have laid down for you. Correct or not, there's a certain age. Only after you reach a certain age do you have access to that wealth. And even then, it may or may not be what you put in. And there are other schemes around as well. I mean, let's talk about lawful ones, permissible ones, where you put in a certain amount of wealth, but you may not take it back. You will not have access to it. You are not free to do with it as you please. You will only become the owner of that property after a certain period of time. But then don't forget, there are also other schemes, if you will, where you put in a certain amount of money, and at any given time, you are allowed to take out. So on that, zakah is due. You're allowed to sell anytime. Let's say your stocks, for example. Can you sell them at any time? Yeah, it's up to you. You want to sell the stocks, you can sell them. So then, zakah will be due on them because of the fact that you have them for the sake of resale. And they become like trade goods. Anyhow. So these are the five conditions that have to be met before zakah, before we can say zakah is wajib, is fard on you. You have to be a Muslim, you have to be free, you have to own that nisab, that bare minimum amount that we talked about, has to be with you for 1 year, and you have possession of it. You have full possession of it. Alright, before we move on, we want to remove some of the confusion that exists in the minds of some when they talk about zakah and sadaqah. What are some of the differences between a zakah and a sadaqah? Okay? A zakah, we talked about it, meaning growth and blessing and purification. A sadaqah comes from a sidq. Huh? A sidq meaning what? Sincerity. And that's why a sadaqah is a sign of the sincerity of an individual's iman or faith. Okay, so now let's talk about some of the differences between az-zakah and as-sadaqah. The first of them is that az-zakah, as we mentioned earlier, is an obligation. It's not a matter of choice. You must pay the zakah if those conditions are met. We already talked about those conditions. And it is due on only specific types of wealth and property. So there are some very specific laws, okay, or regulations governing az-zakah. Even when we talk about livestock, certain types of livestock. When we talk about gold and silver, okay, cash, okay. Even crops, certain types of crops and certain types of fruits only. As for sadaqah, none of those rulings apply. A sadaqah, first of all, is optional. It's optional. You are not obliged to give sadaqah. Are you encouraged to do so? Absolutely. But you are not obliged. Meaning, if you don't pay your zakah, not that you deny it, you don't pay it, you're too cheap, you're too stingy. You don't pay it, it's a sin. You're liable before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You don't pay sadaqah, it's not a sin. It's not a very nice thing maybe, but it's not a sin. Allah will not ask you about it, as He will ask you and hold you accountable for the zakah. For the zakah, what did we say? Zakah only becomes due on that property if one Hijri year, one Islamic calendar year passes. No such law applies to sadaqah. You want to give it any time, you can give. There's no certain value or percentage, if you will, certain proportion of the wealth. No, a sadaqah, you can give as much or as little as you want, and there are no set timings for it, as we found with zakah. Okay? Zakah, there are 8 categories of people, if you will, who are eligible recipients of zakah. A sadaqah, we don't have that. For example, a zakah also can only be given to Muslims. A sadaqah can be given also to non-Muslims. A zakah has to be paid in certain form. So cash, you owe zakah on cash, you have to pay it in cash. Livestock, in the form of livestock, and so forth. A sadaqah, you can give it in any form that you like. You want to give it in cash, you want to give it in diapers, any form that you like. Can't pay zakah in diapers. Huh? So these are a few of those differences. We said one who withholds zakah, it's a punishable crime. Not the case with a sadaqah. If a person dies and they owed zakah on their wealth, the heirs, before receiving their portion of the inheritance, the zakah must be paid from that person, from the deceased's wealth. Not the case with sadaqah. If a person wanted to give sadaqah, for example, and they died before giving it, we can't say, well, of course it's a good thing if the people say, you know what, he wanted to give sadaqah, she wanted to give, I mean, they were passionate about it. So let's take out that sadaqah from our mom's wealth or our father's wealth and give it on their behalf, from their own wealth, alhamdulillah, fine. But you're not obliged to do so. You're not obliged to do so. You just know that they had an intention or they wanted to give and so forth. But if zakah was due, you must take that out from their wealth before it is distributed amongst the heirs. Zakah may not be paid to your dependents. A person's parents or grandparents or great-grandparents, for example, one's children or grandchildren, great-grandchildren, I mean, they are not eligible recipients of zakah. Why? Because their nafaqah, your spending on them, is wajib, fard. So you can't escape that obligation by giving them zakah, no. You are obliged to spend on them. Those whom you are obliged to spend on according to the sharia, you may not pay them from the zakah. A man can't give his wife zakah. Here, honey, buy the groceries with this. But you want to give sadaqah to your wife, to your parents, whatever, you're free to do so. It's not a problem. To your children, you want to give them sadaqah, you may do so. Of course, equally, fairly amongst your children and so forth. Okay? When it comes to zakah, there are some who are very particular. And the Shafi'i madhab, for example, is quite clear on this, where unless there is a pressing need outside, the zakah must be paid in the location where it is due on that individual. And one of the strong evidences they have for that is تُؤْخَذُ مِنْ أَغْنِيَائِكُمْ وَتُرَدُّ عَلَى فُقَرَائِكُمْ. أَغْنِيَائِكُمْ is taken from your wealthy and given to your poor. In other words, in this particular locale. As I said, some of the ulama, most of them agree. Perhaps not all of them say it's an obligation, but most agree that yes, you take care of your own locality first, and sending it elsewhere, yes, it's permissible when there is a pressing need, when there is a benefit to be had from it. And of course, as we know, in this day and age, that happens a great deal. All right, so these are some of the differences between zakah and sadaqah. I hope that is clear. And by the way, we said that sadaqah is used to mean zakah in some cases. And how do we know? From the context. And a sadaqah is also used to mean any good deed. Doesn't have to be in kind. In other words, it doesn't have to be property. It doesn't have to be goods. Even a smile, as the Prophet ﷺ said, in the face of a fellow Muslim, is a sadaqah. All right. So let's move on a little bit. I'll try not to take too much of your time, inshallah. More time has passed than I thought. The types of property or wealth on which zakah is due, and we will deal only with what is relevant to us. We'll mention others, and then we'll move on. So, on certain types of livestock, namely camels, cattle, and sheep. So those who are cattle farmers, see me later. Those who are breeding camels, see me later. I'm not going to talk about it now. Okay? Then you have crops and fruits and even honey. So all you honey farmers, later on. Then we have gold, silver, and cash, which I mentioned earlier. And that is what is most relevant to us, along with trade goods. So these are the different types of wealth and property on which a zakah is due. Who are the eligible recipients of zakah? You look to the Quran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes it abundantly clear. Innama sadaqatu. Notice what is being used here. A sadaqah is being used for a zakah. And I told you that how we will determine whether a sadaqah means zakah or not is through what? Through context. So here, first of all, Allah Jalla wa Ala begins with innama adatu hasrin. وتأكيد. So we have here Allah Jalla wa Ala is saying that this charity, if you will, is only for the following. What we said about sadaqah, it's for pretty much anything, correct? Also, as you go, فَرِيضَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ. Allah Jalla wa Ala near the end of the ayah says it's an obligation from Allah. So clearly from this context, we understand that a sadaqah here means az-zakah. So, إِنَّمَا صَدَقَاتُ لِلْفُقَرَاءِ وَالْمَسَاكِينِ وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ وَالْغَارِمِينَ وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ فَرِيضَةً مِّنَ اللَّهِ وَاللَّهُ عَلِيمٌ حَكِيمٌ. جيد. Zakah expenditures. This is what we're talking about. إِنَّمَا الصَّدَقَاتِ. Zakah expenditures are only for the following categories of people. You cannot use it for anything else. This is what it means. So let's be clear on that. Zakah is separate from sadaqah. The poor and the needy. Now, we call this, you know, zakah made easy, so we don't want to get into the, you know, details. Which ones are poor? The fuqara or the masakin? But anyway, some of them say that the faqir is the one who has or who earns less than half what they require to meet their basic needs. And the miskeen is one who, you know, earns half or more. Either way, they're poor, they're needy, we get the picture. They don't have enough to sustain themselves. All right? وَالْعَامِلِينَ عَلَيْهَا. In an Islamic state, there are people who are hired to collect zakah. They don't have to be poor. They could be wealthy people. But a portion of that zakah is used to pay them. That is permissible according to the Quran. There are certain groups of people who may be wealthy, but still eligible for zakah. This is one of them. Okay? The next one, وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ. Who are they? Basically, I mean, again, there's a lot of talk about whether they still exist today or not. There are some madhahib who say that passed a long time ago, and that's no longer applicable. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam, it is still applicable. And it refers initially to whom? Let's say, for example, you have an individual, and you know, it still exists in certain places. I mean, I know for a fact in some regions in Africa, because I know people there, where they still work on, you know, tribal systems. the chief of the tribe. He has clout. He may be wealthy. He has clout. Even he's non-Muslim. Now, giving him from zakah, in order to soften his heart so he will be inclined towards Islam, serves a great benefit. Because you know, there are many parts of the world where if their leader accepts Islam, everybody will accept Islam. What about the history of Malaysia? Remember how the sultans accepted Islam and what happened? The people followed after. So even in certain regions, by paying them from the zakah, it will cause their hearts to be inclined towards Islam. And of course that is good for them and it is good for the Muslims. And so many will come to Islam as a result of that. Yes, giving them from zakah is prescribed according to the Quran. Or by giving them from the zakah, you will ward off some evil from them and some harm from them. That is also permissible. So this is how they used to use it before. And in this day and age, I mean, I know that we tend to use the word mu'allafa, especially here. I've noticed it here a lot more. You know, people who are new to Islam. Well, not all of them are poor, you know. The person may be new to Islam. But does it mean just because they're new to Islam, you give them this title, mu'allafa, and then you give them from the zakah? No, except that in some cases, perhaps their iman is shaky. This is where, as I said, there's a lot of talk whether this is even allowed or not. But perhaps it is, inshallah ta'ala, where, you know, by giving them from the zakah, it will just reinforce their faith and, inshallah ta'ala, they will remain within the folds of Islam. If they're poor to begin with, you're not giving them because they're mu'allafa, you're giving them because they are fuqara and they are masakeen. Alright? وَالْمُؤَلَّفَةِ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَفِي الرِّقَابِ. Okay, again, this is not something that applies to us, but in the rare cases today where you may use this to ransom, actually it does apply in some places, more than we might imagine, to ransom prisoners, Muslim prisoners, as well as we said earlier, we have a slave, for example, who wants to buy their freedom. Okay, so they have this agreement with their master, and they're collecting from whatever earnings that they may have, and we may give them from the zakah to help free them, to help them buy their freedom as well. وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ I'm sorry, وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. The next one, وَالْغَارِمِينَ. وَالْغَارِمِينَ. الْغَارِمِينَ, this is a category that is very often neglected also, and perhaps more in, you know, for lack of better terms, in the developed countries. And I learned of this firsthand in Canada. We assume that everybody's well-to-do. But there are people who are genuinely in debt. When we talk about al-gharimin, we talk about people who are in debt. Some people are in debt, they don't need to be in debt. Right? Because they gave up their Toyota for a Mercedes. And they had to get a loan for that. Yeah, that person's not eligible for zakah. Right? I don't think any of us would say, yeah, we should pay him from the zakah to pay off that loan on his Mercedes. No, we're talking about people who are genuinely in debt. Allah forbid. You know that medical bills can be high. For us in Canada, we're fortunate. You know, our system is good. The government takes care of it. In America, maybe not so much. In Malaysia, not so much, right? You go to a private hospital with maybe your only option in some cases. Things can get very expensive. And so a person falls into debt because of some need. Something that happened and for it they had to borrow. Allah forbid, an accident, something could have happened. They lost their job. Allah forbid. And there's no real welfare system to assist them. Happens. In this world it happens. Not everybody who is poor is a lazy bum. Get that out of your minds. That is not the case. Some people, it is just the way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala willed it for them. And they need that help for a certain period of time or maybe an extended period of time, depending. So people who are in debt, legitimate debt, okay, they can be given from the zakah. And I personally, walillahi alhamd, have the experience where we have paid off people's debts. Because we realize that, listen, people are ignoring them. They think that, you know, because they're surviving, but you know, they have this huge debt that was incurred out of dire need. And so helping them from the zakah is prescribed as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. This is another one of those categories of people. The person may be wealthy, but stranded somewhere, and they have no access to their wealth. They may be rich back home. They ain't nothing here, though. They got nothing. They don't have any way to get back home. Everything they had was stolen. Their papers were stolen. They have no access to their money. Even Western Union won't do it because they don't have any ID. What do you do for them? You can give them from the zakah so they can get their affairs in order enough to reach home, even if they're rich. And it's not like a loan. They don't have to pay it back. Correct? This is Ibn al-Sabil. But before that, I actually made a mistake. I jumped one. وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ. So what I mentioned now was Ibn al-Sabil. And وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ. This is a problematic one. Not because it's problematic in the Quran, because people have made it problematic. Al-Imam Malik, alayhi rahmatullah, says, وَلَا نَعْلَمُ فِي ذَلِكَ خِلَافًا. When he speaks of وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, he says it's for the mujahideen. Then he says, وَلَا نَعْلَمُ فِي ذَلِكَ خِلَافًا. And I don't know of any difference of opinion on this. But today, وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, I have a Muslim school to build. Okay, فِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, give me from your zakah. We want to build a masjid. Zakah. Everything you want to do, zakah. So, sadaqah, people forget because now I have to pay zakah anyways. Let me give from my zakah. Problematic. People think, oh, there's some, you know, what, this cause and that cause. Everybody wants to ask whether, ya subhanallah. وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, in the cause of Allah, some of them broadened it to pretty much include everything. And that is somewhat problematic. What was everything else before that? وَفِي سَبِيلِ الشَّيْطَانِ? I mean, you know, really we need to think long and hard about this. And especially people who are in positions where they are collecting zakah for projects and so on, they need to be very, very certain that they are eligible, or those projects are eligible for zakah. And I say this with utmost sincerity. Because many people are being deprived of what is due to them. Remember what we said about the zakah? It is the poor due. It is the haqq of the miskeen. It is the haqq of the faqir. It is their right. That property belongs to them. It has to be handed over to them. Those mujahideen who don't receive a stipend, for example, they can be given from the zakah to prepare them and so on. So we have to be very particular about these things. There are many organizations which collect zakah, and Allahu A'lam how diligently they are dealing with those funds. It is a huge, huge amana. And for those of us who are contributors, in other words, we pay the zakah, be certain where you're paying your zakah. Ask, if it is an organization, ask, what will you use it for? We have an orphanage we want to build. It's for the building. Sorry, I give you sadaqah for that, inshallah. But my zakah, no. The orphans who need to be supported, yes, we'll give the orphans. Huh? I mean, they may be young kids, so you're not going to hand them the cash, but whoever is in charge of them. So for example, there are reliable people within that, running that orphanage. They have an account, and this money that they have is for those poor orphans. That's okay, because they're spending on them. They are acting on behalf of them. They are their guardians, right? The guardian is, of course, the one who is going to, even if the money doesn't belong to the guardian, it belongs to the child. But the child is not fit to make decisions on his or her own. So the guardian will do so. So there are so many details. And so, وَفِي سَبِيلِ اللَّهِ, I'm saying we need to be very cautious when it comes to that particular one. وَابْنِ السَّبِيلِ, we mentioned, and we said, فَرِيضَةً مِنَ اللَّهِ, an obligation that has been imposed upon us by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, who is Hakim, Alim, and who is Hakim. In other words, he is knowing, and he is wise. Alright. We need to conclude. So what I want to do is just maybe quickly talk about a few things that comes, or a few things that come to mind, that questions that may arise, and then I will leave it for you to ask questions as well, and something about the calculation of the zakah. Okay, we mentioned the nisab of gold being 85 grams, the nisab of silver being 595 grams. I said there were some details we will talk about. This is the time for those details. I don't want to confuse you, but you know, we need to know these things. There are two opinions among the ulama or the scholars, whether or not these should be or need to be combined. Okay? So, you have gold, about 80 grams of gold. And you have silver, about 400 grams of silver. There are those who say, as long as the gold has not reached 85 grams, and let's say you have no cash, okay? You have gold, hasn't reached 85 grams, you don't owe any zakah on the gold. Silver has not reached 595 grams, you don't owe any zakah on the silver. There's no need to combine them and say, and now let's look at the value, and is zakah due or not. Insha'Allah ta'ala, that opinion is the most sound of opinions. However, if you want to play it safe, and I always like to err on the side of caution, although I may agree with an opinion, but where, you know, there is room, we say, yeah, maybe it's better to play it safe. If you were to combine the two, then it would definitely make nisab pay zakah. And by the way, it's not the revenue agency, it's Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for whom you're doing it. So it's a win-win situation if you pay zakah on that. But if you're going to be particular, especially for our sisters, for example, you have gold jewelry, but it hasn't reached 85 grams. Silver that has not reached the 595 grams. Separately, you do not owe zakah on them. All right? Now we come to the cash. We said the cash, if the value reaches, and again, we're playing it safe, the 595 grams of silver, what is it worth? Again, I don't know the exact figure, but let me just throw out $300, let's say. Okay? Earlier I said 350, right? But I'm just throwing out numbers. Let's say it's $300. 595 grams of gold, for the sake of argument, is worth $300 today. If you have more than $300 or more, that means you have the nisab. You have full possession of it. You can do whatever you want with it. And it lasts you for that hawl, which we spoke about earlier, the one Islamic calendar year, then zakah is due on that cash. Even if you were saving up for a house, even if it was in your savings for when you get older and you retire, inshallah you make it. Even if you're saving it for your children's education, it's in your possession. You owe zakah on it. It doesn't matter what you've earmarked it for. Things can change. You may not last. The one for whom you are saving it may not last. Right? Plans change. That's life. As long as you have that value, as long as you have that amount of cash, you owe it at a rate of 2.5%. The easiest calculation is cash, right? Whatever amount it is, times 2.5%, end of story. That is how much you will owe zakah on your cash. Let's go back to the gold and talk about how you will calculate the zakah. For those of you who have gold, even men, you're allowed to own it, you're not allowed to wear it. When you want to buy jewelry and keep it as an investment, it's up to you. Men are allowed to own gold. We are not allowed to use it on our persons. Women are allowed to own it and to use it for beautification, jewelry. Okay? We're not talking about what you have in your possession for the sake of reselling. That's not what I'm talking about here. I'm talking about gold, let's say, that you have with you, whether it be in the form of those chips or bricks or jewelry. You keep it with you for, let's say, investment purposes, right? Instead of keeping it in cash, you keep it in gold because you know that inshallah it will increase in value. You're allowed to do that, not a problem, but you owe zakah on it. If they are the bricks or the chips, that's pure gold. Very simple. 85 grams of gold, how much is each gram worth? Or you may have more, whatever, 85 or more. Whether it's 85 grams or a kilogram, 1,000 grams, times the price per gram gives you how much the value is. Let's say, I know it's more, but let's say that gold is $1,000. Oh no, that's a troy ounce. Let's say it is $50 a gram. If I'm not mistaken, it's maybe more than that. But let's say $50 a gram. You have 100 grams times the $50 gives you how much? 5,000. So you know the value, $5,000 times 2.5%, and you pay zakah on it. Simple, easy, all right. What if it's in the form of jewelry? In the form of jewelry, you do not look at how much you paid for it, nor do you look at how much the jeweler will give you for it. Understood? This is gold in your possession. It's in the form of a bracelet, in the form of a chain, whatever form of jewelry it may be. You're not looking at what the market value is, whether it's how much you will buy it for or how much you will sell it for. Especially our sisters will know. When you go to buy gold, let's say you buy a necklace for $1,000. 2 minutes later, you want to sell it. Are you going to get $1,000 for it? You're not going to get $1,000 for it. You're going to get less. Unless you meet somebody stupid who's willing to pay you more. So why? Because they have not only charged you for the value of the gold, they have also worked in the workmanship cost. And depending on, I mean, you may now be looking at two different rings. They both weigh 5 grams. But one is worth 500, the other is only worth 300. Why? The one worth 500 has a lot of intricate work in it. And so, they're charging you for the workmanship. So that doesn't come into play at all when we're calculating for zakah. We want to know how much gold is there. And the zakah is due on that gold, whatever the value of gold is. Similarly, if you're going to sell, of course they want to give you less because they want to turn it around and make a profit. So they're not going to give you even probably the value of the gold because they can buy that anywhere. This is more work because now they have to melt it and do whatever else. So you don't look at either of those two values. This is what you will do. You will take your gold jewelry and you will weigh it. But before that, you will divide it into... Questions? You will divide it up according to the purity of the gold, meaning how many carats is it? Okay? So write that formula down. This is what you will do. You will say, again, our example is 100 grams of gold. Okay? And you have... That 100 grams is 18 carat. So you will say 100 times 18 over 24. Why? Because pure gold is 24 carat. So you, when you go 18 over 24, what is the other 6? That is some impurity. In other words, something other than gold, maybe copper or whatever else they use in order to make that jewelry. So times 18 over 24 times... how much a gram of gold costs. Because that price is for 24 karat gold. It's equal to, that's the value of the gold you have. Now, you multiply it by 2.5% to know how much zakah you owe on that 18 karat gold of yours. You do the same thing for 9 karat gold if you happen to have 9 karat gold. Except 18 over 24 will change to 9 over 24. And so forth. 14 carat, 19, 22 carat, whatever it may be. Is that clear? Because you want to see how much real gold you have, and you will pay based on that. Another factor to consider is this. Stones that are on that ring that you may have. Maybe you have a gold ring. When you weigh it with the stone, that's not how much gold there is. So it's without the stone. What do you do in such a case? In such a case, you can't say, well, I estimate that the stones are about so many grams. No. You need to be a lot more accurate than that. So either you will do this. You will say, it's for Allah. I don't mind. I'll include that as, you know, part of the weight. I don't have a problem with it. Which means that you're going to pay more. Alhamdulillah, not a problem. But if you're watching the pennies, then you take it to a jeweler, for example. Right? Somebody who is a professional and can determine for you the approximate weight of that stone. I mean, little tiny stones, please don't even bother. Just include it as part of it. Right? But you know, if you've got a honking stone on there, yeah, you may want to, it may be heavier than the ring itself. You'll probably want to, want to do something like that. You do it once, of course, you record it. I mean, just tips when it comes to calculating zakah. I mean, I do it for several family members and so on. So what we do is, whatever I've done for them in 1 year, I record it. Because, I mean, you know, these are women folk who are not going to sell their jewelry all the time, and you know, they're going to keep it. So some of them have had the same jewelry for years. I mean, I don't have to go and weigh it every year again. So I make a note of it and ask if anything has been given away or if they've added anything, and then we add the new stuff afterwards. So keep a note of things. You have this ring, and if you know now how much gold there is in it and how much the stones weigh, make a note of it so you don't have to redo the whole thing every single year. Make a note of it and make life a lot easier for yourself. So if we understood how we will determine how much zakah is owed on your gold jewelry, so whatever number of grams times whatever carats over 24 times the price of a gram of gold, so that gives you the value of the gold that you have, and multiply that by 2.5%. Relatively easy. It's not all that difficult. All right. So, and then let's talk about trade goods. Trade goods meaning that you have a shop, for example. You are selling things, whether it be groceries that you are selling, whether it be clothing that you're selling, whether it be vehicles that you're selling. These are trade goods. Urud at-tijara, things that you purchase in order to sell. Okay? If you have things in your possession, and your niyyah, your intention is that these things are for sale. These things are for sale. Okay? Then zakah is due on them if the value reaches the nisab. And of course we talked about the hawl. So, I have stock in my shop. Alright? It reached the nisab. I paid the zakah. The following year, I have to see the stock again. How much stock do I have? Don't count what you paid for it. Don't say, my cost was, you know, I got a really good deal. I only paid $2 a piece, but they sell for 10. You don't count it as that. You count its market value on that day when you're calculating the zakah. What will you get for it? Understood? You have it in your store, you have it advertised, I'm selling it for $10 a piece. I don't care that you paid $2 or even a dollar for that matter. You calculate at $10. Unless you have a policy where you're willing to sell it for $8. Especially, you know, in certain places where they're bargaining. So everybody knows, I'll probably get $8 for it. So, you know, your expected sale value is $8. Okay, you count it as that. Irrespective of what you paid. Because remember, it works the other way also. Sometimes you end up buying things and the value of it goes down, and people are stuck with those goods and they have to sell it below cost. So, we're not going to say calculate at the value at which you purchased, but what are you going to get for it today? Alright? Now the same type of thing will apply to your stocks. Right? You invest in a company. Now investing in a company can be tricky also. Let's say that you're one of those people who buys and sells stocks. Okay? And that is what most people do. Let's be very frank. Most people don't do, I want to be a partner in that company. I'm going to sit on it for as long as I can. Not too many people do that. But the average person who deals with stocks, they wait for the price to go up and then they're going to sell it. So we treat them also like urud at-tijara, meaning that don't look at what you paid. Look at what it's worth on the day that you have to do your zakah. Okay? A few more quick things. Zakah is not attached to Ramadan. Is that clear? There are people who have this misconception that zakah is due only in Ramadan. No, ya Habibi. It might or it might not be. If you chose Ramadan as the time that you will pay zakah because it's easier for you, because you'll be reminded in Ramadan, that's okay. That's not a problem. As long as you haven't delayed paying zakah. But if you think that zakah is only to be given in Ramadan, or that by giving in zakah in Ramadan, there is more virtue in it, there's more reward in it. No. That's not true. Your zakah, I mean, for a person who didn't have the nisab at all, not in Ramadan. Okay? So do we have to say you only start counting when Ramadan comes about? No. So let's say in the month of Rabi'un al-Awwal, that's when you had the nisab. Your year starts on whatever day of Rabi'un al-Awwal we're talking about, whether the 20th day or the 17th day or whatever day it may be. You look the next year, remember we talked about looking at the two ends of the year, as long as the nisab has not dipped below, the value has not dipped below the nisab, you look at the two ends of the year. So you owe zakah when? Next year, on the 17th, is when you will owe zakah again. You look at the two ends of the year. If you chose, now you want it to be in Ramadan, it is fine. But when this Ramadan comes, even though the year is not up, you can pay in advance. By the way, you're allowed to pay zakah in advance up to 2 years. You're allowed to pay zakah in advance up to 2 years. So you said, although my hawl started in Rabi al-Awwal, but I want to pay every Ramadan, it's okay. When Ramadan comes, pay zakah. So you paid in advance, not a big deal. Okay? And then come from this Ramadan to the next, and you make your hawl now in Ramadan. Like the fiscal year. People can choose their fiscal year. So you're zakatable. Your zakah here, you can choose it as well, as long as you don't allow any months to go by when you didn't pay zakah, when zakah was actually due on your wealth. Another misconception. Okay, so the thing about Ramadan, you all understand, right? If you want to choose Ramadan, it's okay. But don't think that you must pay zakah only in Ramadan. But if you've chosen that, and you started paying in Ramadan, yeah, now your hawl becomes every Ramadan. Simply because you chose it to be that way. Not because the Sharia stipulates that it must be in Ramadan. Another one. A woman says, honey, I got like 700 grams of gold. Can you pay the zakah for me? Well, you have to pay my zakah for me. Honey, I don't have to pay your zakah for you. That's your honey. Alright? So, it's an individual obligation. The head of the household is not responsible for the zakah of those who are under him in his home. If my kids are wealthy independently, they owe their own zakah. I don't owe zakah on their behalf. I'm not obliged to pay zakah on their behalf. I'm not obliged to pay zakah on behalf of my wife. If I offer, or if she asks me and I agree to pay zakah on her behalf, that's a favor I'm doing her and it will be acceptable. But only with her permission. I cannot pay zakah on her behalf without her knowledge. Because zakah is an act of ibadah and it requires a niyyah. So unless she authorize me to pay zakah on her behalf, that duty has not been discharged. Is that clear to everyone? So everyone within the household is responsible for their own zakah. The wife is responsible for herself, the children are responsible for their own zakah, the husband is responsible for his own zakah from their own property and from their own wealth. If someone wants to pay on behalf of someone else, from their own wealth, it has to be with the knowledge of the one whom they're paying on behalf of. All right? Okay. I think I will stop there, because if I keep going, there's just so much more that keeps coming to mind. Okay, let's stop there, inshallah ta'ala, and we'll now deal with a few questions that I have received, and then we'll open the floor if there are still some questions. Okay, Zakatul Fitr. Alright, Zakatul Fitr is what is owed at the end of the month of Ramadan. You are obliged to pay it before Salatul Eid, but you may pay it, and when I say pay it, to the recipients of Zakatul Fitr a day or two before Eid as well. The hikmah or the wisdom behind it, أغنوهم عن السؤال. The Prophet ﷺ told us that we owe, or we should pay Zakatul Fitr to those who are eligible, the poor and the needy, to free them, you know, from having to ask. I mean, the day of Eid is the day of celebration. Why should they be begging for food? Why should they be begging for anything? So free them of that burden. That's why we give Zakatul Fitr. That's why it may be given up to 2 days before the day of Eid. How much is due and how is it due? First of all, Zakatul Fitr is not to reach the recipients in the form of cash. It has to reach them in the form of food. You, mind you, might give it to someone in the form of cash so they can buy the food and give it to the others, the recipients on your behalf. That you can do, right? I mean, let's say for example, there's a brother who says, yes, I know the homes where, you know, people are eligible and so on, you know, and so I say, here, you know, take the money. This is for so many people. All right, so you can buy, for example, so many kilos of rice with that, which is, roughly speaking, 3 kilograms of rice per person. So let's say the cost of 3 kilograms of rice is 10 ringgit, for example. So I give you 30 for 3 people in my family, buy 9 kilograms of rice and give to 3 different people who are eligible to receive Zakatul Fitr. I can give him in the form of money, but I have now made him responsible to go and buy the food and give it in the form of food. That's what I mean. Ultimately, they cannot receive it in the form of cash, although some of the Hanafi ulama say that it is allowed, but it is contrary to the sunnah of the Prophet ﷺ, and that is why the vast majority of scholars say that no, it must be given in the form of the staple food there. Clearly here, it's rice. Okay, that's why I'm talking rice. Okay, so Zakatul Fitr is due on every individual in the household, from the husband right down to the kids. Technically speaking, the husband is responsible for it, the head of the household. So the father will pay on behalf of the children and the wife. He will pay on behalf of his wife also. However, my recommendation is everyone gives on their own behalf. We need to train our children to become charitable as well. It's not a big, I mean, you know, 3 kilos of rice. I mean, it doesn't even cost 10 ringgit. I just threw out 10 ringgit. But let's say even if it was 10 ringgit. Right? But can you imagine when you train your child to open their wallet or their money box and take out 10 ringgit, they feel that they're giving from their wealth and that it is going to the poor and the needy. And what is even better than that is when you actually go out with them and you buy the 3 kilos of rice and they deliver it firsthand to those who are in need. That is even better. Right? So, technically though, the head of the household is responsible for everyone. If a woman is pregnant and has not given birth by the time the day of Eid comes about, there is no Zakatul Fitr due on the unborn child. But if you wish to give on behalf of that unborn child, then it is a good thing, as Uthman radiallahu ta'ala anhu arda'ahu did. Okay? The Nisab, again. On cash, do you choose silver or gold? I said the safest bet is to go according to silver. Okay, because it's not ridiculously low right now. So the safest bet is to go with silver. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. A man who is eligible to pay the zakah, meeting all the criteria at the end of the hawl, does he pay from what he has left at the end of the hawl, or he pays from the minimum balance in that year, considering it is above the nisab? No. What you have in your possession at the end of the hawl. Okay? So what do you owe zakah on? On not only the nisab. You don't say, what I have minus the nisab. No. If you met the nisab, the whole amount. So if you have 10,000 today, then you owe zakah on the 10,000, even if throughout the year you may have had only 5,000 or 7,000. Person may ask, but then, you know what? A year hasn't passed on all of that wealth. You want to make life difficult for yourself, go ahead. Okay? Go find yourself a nice computer program where you can have every penny that you earn, you say exactly when it came in, and whether and what remained of it, and stayed with you for 1 year. I mean, it's possible. And I'm not mocking. But there are some people who are very wealthy. And probably for them that's a better way to go. In terms of, you know, I mean, it's a lot of money. Okay? So, for them, yes. In some cases, it makes sense. Total sense to do it that way. But for the average person, look at the two ends of the year. As long as it didn't dip below the nisab, you had... So, whatever you pay. So, somebody would say, but I just got paid like last month, and it's only the middle of this month, and I'm paying zakah on something that hasn't even stayed with me for 2 weeks. Yeah. It's true. But that is considered giving it in advance. I mean, it eventually works itself out. Remember I said you can give zakah even in advance. The only reason we say this, we recommend this, is that it is the easiest possible way. Unless you really want to go through the hire accountant or whatever you may want to do. And that is a person's right. It is the right of an individual to keep track of when the money comes in and how much of it remains for a year, and they pay the zakah on each amount. And what is left of it after 1 year, they have the right to do that. That is not a right I or anybody else can take away. But it involves a lot of work. And of course, people who are very wealthy, they can probably afford to hire somebody who runs a program that they can do the calculations for them and so forth. Okay? But according to the question here, yes, what you have at the end, even if in between it came a little bit low, not below the nisab, but it was the nisab or more. So you see what you have at the end of the year and pay zakah on that amount. Does a man have to pay zakah for the money he lent to others? An excellent question, of course. If you loaned money to someone, zakah is due on it. If you're pretty certain you're going to get it back. If it's a write-off or more than likely to be a write-off, then only you don't pay zakah. If it's come to a point where you've tried and you know the person is just not interested in paying back, or the person is having such a difficult time that it is more than likely that you're not going to get your money back, in that case you don't owe zakah. But the moment they pay, then you pay for 1 year zakah then. Okay? Maybe it took 5 years and they finally paid you and you were like not expecting it. You pay zakah for 1 year, inshallah ta'ala. Okay? Because it was pretty much considered to be gone. What you may not do is say, oh, I owe zakah anyway and you owe me that money, I'll just keep it as zakah. You cannot do that. Because when you gave it, you didn't have the niyyah or the intention of paying it in the form of zakah. Is that clear to you? You cannot say, let's just turn that loan into zakah. That you may not do. You cannot change the niyyah at that time.
Can you change
it
to sadaqah? I'm sorry?
Yes, excellent. You can say it's a sadaqah and forgive that loan, and there's a great reward for it as well. Ahsanti, excellent.
When you give zakah, do you have to say, is this zakah money or sadaqah money?
Okay. You do not have to if you know that the person is eligible for zakah. If a person is eligible for zakah, and you're giving them, and telling them might offend them, but you know they are eligible, then you give them and not a problem. Okay? But if you're not certain, find out if they are eligible for zakah or not. Because maybe they're not eligible. And you know, some people, subhanAllah, again, I've had these surprises where you actually think that people are eligible for charity and zakah, but really they're not. They're richer than you are. Right? But they just don't show it. And that's not always a good thing. You know, as an individual, Imam Abu Hanifa rahimahullah saw an individual who looked poor and, you know, raggedy and torn clothing and so forth. And the person was wealthy. Allah Jalla wa Ala had given him a lot of wealth. And he rebuked him. He said, you know, when according to the sunnah of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala blesses you with wealth, then He loves to see the traces of that blessing on you. Right? Not to be extravagant, but if Allah has given you, why do you want to dress like a pauper? Allah has given you, wear nice clothing. Wear good shoes. You don't have to wear torn things and, you know, broken shoes that you put them together with twist ties and, you know, elastic bands. I mean, what for? Allah has given you. Use it. As I said, we're not saying to be extravagant, but use what Allah has given you and let those traces of His ni'mah appear on you, as the Prophet ﷺ said. Can zakah be paid for a special child to receive special education? Parents are not poor, but cannot afford the fees for the child's education. Tayyib. If the parents cannot afford it, the child cannot afford it, okay, you can give the zakah in the form of cash and say, you know what, use this for your child's education, for example, inshallah ta'ala, that is fine because the child is poor. The child is poor and needy and needs that education. And the child needs that education, inshallah ta'ala, it is permissible. Okay, those who are getting paid a salary by the government to work, you know, in collecting the zakah and so on and so forth, they don't take from the zakah unless, I mean, maybe I don't know how it works. Maybe the government is paying them from the zakah fund. If they are, then of course, that is legitimate. That is legitimate because they are al-amilina alayha. Okay? But if they're receiving a salary anyways, and that salary is coming from a different source, and part of the work is to do with zakah, now they can't say, oh, now give me from the zakah also. No, no, no. You're already getting paid for that job. What about precious stones such as diamonds, emerald, ruby, sapphire, and so on and so forth? If you have them in the form of jewelry, you're a collector, whatever, you do not owe zakah on it unless you trade in those stones. Then they are considered to be trade goods. And so you pay zakat as you would on your groceries or your clothing or whatever else on which you are you're trading in. Okay? So you only pay zakah on those precious stones and other precious metals, other than gold and silver, only if you are trading in them. You bought them, you have them for the sake of reselling. Then, but just because they may be your jewelry and whatever, no. The nas, the text did not come saying that we owe zakah on them. Okay? How do you pay zakah from previous years? Hasbunallahu wa ni'mal wakil. Okay, so let's say a person was negligent. Huh? I mean, we're human beings. We go through times wherein, you know, we didn't see things as we should have seen them. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive us. You want to do tawbah, you repent to Allah Azza wa Jal, and you calculate zakah for previous years. Well, you have to go back to each of those years and see what was in your possession. Just as you would calculate zakah for this year, you see for previous years as well. Hmm? Good luck in doing that. I mean, some people it's easier than, for some people it'll be easier than others. But whatever you do, err on the side of caution. Huh? 10 years ago, yes, I remember I had, mashallah, had a fair amount of money. And maybe, especially the way that we work today, you know, bank statements and whatever else. But people generally have an idea of the wealth that they had. Refugees, are they eligible for zakat? Yes, if they are poor, if they fall under any of those categories, they're poor, they're needy, they can't support themselves, yes, they're eligible for zakat. We pay them, we give it to them directly. As long as they're adults and they're responsible, huh, then we pay the zakat to them directly. Okay, not through an intermediary. Meaning that we don't give it to someone and say, spend on them from this money, it's zakat for them. No, give it to them. It will be their possession, and they should be free to do with it as they please. Can a company or its owners pay zakah that is due from its profit to the company's own staff who are eligible? Yes, another excellent question. A company owner has staff, and it so happens, although they're getting paid, but maybe their pay is low, and that person is either in debt or the person, you know, I mean, the pay, it doesn't cover that person's basic needs. And we say that person's basic needs, that person and their dependents. So when you're talking about an individual, a man, for example, he's responsible for his entire household. He's responsible for his wife and his children. So if his salary is not enough to cover those needs, he's always in debt and so on and so forth. So although you're paying him a salary, from your zakah, you can also give that individual, you being the owner of the company, you may give that individual from the zakah, has nothing to do with the salary. It has to be with them being eligible recipients of the zakah. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. If I pay zakah for one Islamic calendar year, but there is a recipient, can I pay zakah for the next year in advance? Yes, we answered that, alhamdulillah. You can pay up to 2 years in advance. Hmm? Zakah is not payable on a house that is rented, but the rental is to be calculated for zakah. Is that correct? Yes. So the home that you are staying in, homes that you own for the sake of owning, but you're not, you didn't buy them for the sake of reselling them. Homes that you own for rental purposes, you do not owe zakah on the home or the value of the home. Okay? You have a weekend cottage somewhere, you have a chalet there, you have a home here, you have a home there, those are all your property and you make use of them. You use them for your own purposes. Maybe you only stay a week, a year, a day, a year, I don't care. But they're not for resale. That's your property. It could be worth tens of millions. You don't owe zakat on it. You own a home and you're earning money through it by renting it out. From the rental, you include it as part of your wealth, right? And if it meets the nisab, you may have spent it all. You may not have spent it, depending on if it remains or not. Then only you would owe zakah on it. Wallahu a'lam. Yes.
But what can it be you that intention is to not, if you have cash, you have to pay. But if you buy property, you don't pay, even if you weren't rent it out. Can that be you as a way of
reading? If that's what your intention is, then you pay zakah on it. But no, a person who buys property and sits on it. Okay? Listen, whatever that person's intention is, Allah Jalla wa'ala is aware of it. If that person's intention is to sell it, because it's, you know, they say, well, I'll evade paying zakah. You know, people treat zakah sometimes and evading payment of zakah like they do taxes. They don't realize they're dealing with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah knows if their intention is that ultimately they want to sell it. And if ultimately they want to sell it, that's the reason that they bought it, then they owe zakah on it. Then they owe zakah on it. Okay? But some people buy it because they want it to go to their children later. It's okay. They don't owe zakah on it. I mean, this is property that they own. They're going to be handing it over to their children. They're using it and renting it out. That's all fine. Okay, that's not a problem at all. When zakah is payable, can I spread the payment of zakah over a few months? I'm glad that question came up. It's one of those things I was going to say, and I said, no time. Okay. Not unless there is a pressing need to do so. Why? Zakah is not mine. That money is not mine. When I take that zakah out, that is not my money. There are people who that zakah belongs to. Why prolong their misery? They are in need now. So if they are there, you must give it to them. A need? Oh, okay. You know, I have to delay it a short while. Why? Because that person isn't in town yet. Okay, I'm traveling in like a few weeks and I want to give it to them and they're in dire need and whatever. Okay, you know, a short period of time, it's okay. But delaying it unnecessarily without a valid reason is not allowed. Okay, pay it over a few months. Except if you took your zakah out in advance. Some people pay zakah 1 or 2 years in advance. If you do that, then you can pay over, you know, monthly. And so, yeah, it's fine. Why? Because the zakah is not yet due. Right? You're paying it in advance anyhow. So then it's not a problem. But if you're paying zakah and it was due at that time, then it must be given as soon as possible. Yeah? Without delay. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Is it okay if we do monthly deductions for zakah? It's up to you. If you want to do that, it is up to you. But you know, you look at the two ends of the year. If you want to pay in advance, like you want to pay monthly, again, that is up to you. But the Sharia does not oblige you to do so. If you do that, and you probably will pay more than what is even due on you. But if that's fine, I mean, you are saying it's for the sake of Allah, I don't mind paying more. You are free to do so, but you are not obliged. Okay? What you're obliged to do is pay at the end of the Islamic calendar year. Okay, Zakat al-Fitr, we already answered that one. Zakah on monthly salaries that government deducts monthly. Yeah, that, you know, I don't want to say too much on that, except that it doesn't sound fair to me. Because some people's salary, I mean, you take zakah from it, and I'm in need of that money. You're preventing me from maybe making a purchase that I want to make. That money is mine. Zakah is only due on it after a year. So this is not just to take it from me in advance. If I give it willingly, that's another story. If I say to you, deduct every month, that's my choice. I want to give it to you in advance. Not a problem. But an Islamic government, for example, does not have the authority to take zakah in advance from people. That is a choice that they make. But once the year is up and the person hasn't paid zakah, then yes. They have a right, of course, to go and say, you owe zakah, you better pay it. Okay? But you take that zakah from me, and I may have had plans. I have a big purchase to make. And that wealth may be used up, and it won't last till the next year. And you've taken zakah on it. What right do you have to do that? Huh? Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Any other questions or comments? Yes.
Unlike Saudi Arabia, where zakah is codified, everything pays zakat. Unlike in Malaysia, you have the tax system which is applicable to Muslims, and then the zakat is not forced upon you, but it's voluntary, right? But if Muslims pay to the zakat authorities, then whatever they pay can be offset against the tax that they pay. Now my question is...
By the way, in Saudi Arabia, they have taxes now too.
They have tax for non-Muslims, I suppose.
No, even for Muslims now.
Okay.
Anyway, we're not going to talk about that.
The question is, if many of us do not wish to pay through the zakat authorities, but we pay because we're poor relatives, and someone has asked a question, Muslim person will be paying twice.
Okay. Taxes, first of all, as a general principle, are not looked well upon in Islam. Okay? As a general principle. This is, you know, your property, and, you know, people shouldn't stipulate certain amounts that they take, and, you know, import taxes and this tax and that tax. These things, as a general rule, are haram to take to begin with. Okay? Having said that, living in a country where it is the law and you cannot get away from it, what do? You pay. Right? I live in Canada, I have no choice, but, you know, my income is declared. I have to pay. I live in Malaysia, I pay taxes too. I don't want to. I feel that it's unjust, but it's the law of the land. I have no choice, so I pay. Where I can, you know, have deductions made, that's fine. I mean, as long as it's legal and, you know, I'm not doing anything underhanded, by all means, to reduce my, you know, I'm allowed to buy a computer, what, every 3 years, is it? Or whatever it is, yeah? I can declare it, not a problem, okay? To reduce the taxes. So, this is the issue of the taxes. Now, if we happen to be, it happens to be that they're dealing with us unjustly by taking those taxes, and then we're paying zakah, but not to the zakah authority. Okay, we're paying zakah separately. Well, you're going to pay zakah on what is with you. The taxes are deducted from that anyways. Correct or not? So from whatever wealth that you have, taxes have been taken away, but with that you still have some excess wealth. So the zakah is only on what remains with you. You're not going to pay zakah on what has been given as taxes. Those taxes were going to be given regardless, even by non-Muslims. So they're not really interrelated. But the interesting thing is that if you pay zakah through that authority, it will offset the taxes. Well, the taxes shouldn't have been taken from you anyways. So go ahead. You know, deduct. Big deal. You know, it's good for you, as a matter of fact. It's better for you. Okay? But again, as long as they're dealing with the zakah properly and paying it in the right way, you give. I mean, it's zakah. This is an obligation. This is a right of the poor and the needy. Huh? As much as we can, if we can firsthand give, or through, you know, through people whom we know that they're going to take it directly to the people who are needy, that is always better than giving it to organizations which you may not be certain about. Unless, if there's an organization, and mashallah, they are well reputed, and so on and so forth, we trust them, alhamdulillah, we give through them. Wallahu a'lam. Sister in the back? Sister, you had a question also? Yes.
You mentioned earlier that we can't give zakat to our parents, right?
Yes.
Can we give zakat to our siblings that have fallen on hard times?
No. So we said on your you cannot give zakat to your dependents. So your parents and your children, for a man, his wife, they are his dependents. He is obliged to spend on them. Okay? He cannot, you know, get rid of that obligation by giving zakat. But you know, you may have uncles and aunts. You may have siblings who are going through difficult times. To give them zakah is perfectly allowed in Islam, because they are not your dependents. And as a matter of fact, by the way, if you have relatives, whether they be uncles or cousins or whatever, giving zakah to them, giving sadaqah to them, takes preference over giving sadaqah to those who are not related to you. Because giving sadaqah is something which brings great reward. But it's a double reward when you give it to a relative, because not only have you given sadaqah, but you have also maintained those family ties. So it is even more rewarding, bi-idhnihi subhanahu wa ta'ala. Okay? Yes.
Are you saying that if we donate to overseas, like Syrian or Myanmar, is that organization, that's not considered zakah?
It is if you know that they're spending it as it should be spent. You know, zakah has to reach those people directly. If it's, you cannot give zakah in the form of food. See, if they are now saying we're going to use the zakah to buy food, I'm sorry, but you can't do that. This zakah should be given to them in the form of cash. Okay? Because your zakah, you paid in cash, they receive it in cash. They know better what to do with their money. I mean, remember, one of the purposes of zakah, because we don't have time to get into all the details, but you know, the majority of ulama, what do they tell you? How? Because a question that I'm a little bit surprised that it didn't come up, maybe it was going to, how much do you give a person of zakah? Let's say that there's that poor or needy person. How much should I give them? Do you know that they should be given, or they can be given, what will suffice them for an entire year? 1 year. Yes, to maintain them for a year. Because we want a society that is not filled with beggars. Right? Zakah is meant to bridge that gap between poor and wealthy. We want to assist people and make them dependent. So we give them zakah for, you know, okay, so we know they're earning, for example, $1,500 a month. They need 3,000. They cannot survive with less than 3,000. They need 3,000 because they have kids, they have, you know, all these needs. They cannot make ends meet. So what is the shortfall? It works out to about $1,500 a month. We give them, multiply that by 12, give them 1 year's worth. Huh? Or in some cases, and alhamdulillah, it is being done in some places, maybe not too many, where they say, all right, this is what we will do. In order for you to become independent, huh? You're a fisherman, but you can't afford a boat. You can't afford the equipment. No, I don't go and buy the equipment for you. I cannot do that. But I give you enough money to go and do all of that. Yeah, why not? Isn't that a wonderful system? Where you empower people. You give them that wealth so they can become independent and they will not beg. And let me tell you, I have seen examples firsthand. People whom we have given zakah to, because you know, others have given me zakah, and you know who may need, because people used to come to the Islamic Society where I was. We would visit homes. I mean, of course, we do interviews. You have to be diligent. When somebody says, oh, I need, I'm eligible for zakah. You know, come in their BMW and, you know, sure you do. Okay. I offer them groceries, they know I want money. It's happened. It has happened. Offer them groceries, they don't want it. They want money. Okay. So what do? We go through interviews and see if they have debts. Okay, let me see the statements. And we live in a time in a day and age where we have all these things. And surely, I would find many of them in that condition. Alhamdulillah, we help them out. And subhanAllah, you see, after that, they're so relieved. They had that debt hanging over them, and now they're relieved, and Allah Azza wa Jalla blesses them, and they're able to now get on their own two feet, and you see the next thing, they are donating to the center, for example. Yes, it happens. It happens quite often. So we want to make people independent. We want them to be able to earn on their own. And the zakah is one of those means that can help people that are going through those difficult times. Okay?
Yes. Or Syria, and you donate
the
to the
organizers. Yes. So what I'm saying, what I'm saying is, why don't we give them from our sadaqah? Why don't we give them from our sadaqah, which is not the zakah? This is why I say that sometimes, you know, people fall through the cracks and whatever. And zakah also, it's something which the people have to be given ownership of. Okay? Yes, you give it to them in the form of cash, or if you're giving it in gold, which is like cash, we give it to them in those forms. And in some cases, like with livestock, for example, it's given in the form of livestock. In the case of fruits, it's given in the form of fruits. And so you give them full possession of that wealth. And that, this is why I'm saying that, you know, you can empower people in that way. They can become responsible, and they can, you know, and this is why we live in very different times. And so one of the things that we used to do is, when we do give zakah, we also try to help people in another way. And that is, we give them some, for lack of better terms, financial counseling, right? So the person fell into debt. So we try to find out the reasons, right? And then help them to strategize and plan so that they don't fall into debt again, right? We need to help one another. Huh? We also don't want people just to become so dependent on the system. And you know that this happens in many Western countries, like the welfare states, right? Some European countries, even Canada, for example, right? Where some people, they live on the welfare system. They had rather not work. And that's why when giving zakah, also, is that person healthy and capable of working? If the person is capable, then they should not receive zakah. Go out and work. What are you sitting there and then you want people to work for you and support you? That's not fair either. But if the person is working and still they can't make ends meet, or the person is ill in some way, shape, or form, So again, up to the issue of what is being sent here and there, we want to know how they are giving it. If they're giving it to the people and they're empowering them, alhamdulillah, good, fine and dandy. We want to assist. You want to buy them food? Here's from my sadaqah, alhamdulillah. These are our brothers and sisters, please. Huh? I mean, just last week, Thursday, as a matter of fact, I went out with a group of children, and we delivered to needy people right here, just outside KL, Hulu Langat, they call it, right, that area. We went and distributed to people. I could not believe my eyes. that, you know, what type of poverty exists just in our backyard. And that was not from zakah, that was all from sadaqah. Right? Some parents became aware of it, and maybe others as well. And the Muslims are a giving people, walillahi alhamd. Huh? But you and I have to be diligent. I know that the vast majority, if not all, are willing to give zakah and sadaqah. So, just be diligent about it. Sadaqah, give freely, wherever, in whatever form. They're going to give it in food, they're going to build homes. Alhamdulillah, these are things we should support. Huh? Zakah, think about how you can empower those poor and the needy. Here, you may have people that are so poor, and imagine if you give them, they may be able to use that money in order to establish themselves and have a regular income. You know, these people in some of the villages and some of the outlying areas, maybe with that money that you give them, they can go and buy a small plot of land. Or they can afford to, maybe they even have some property. Now they can afford to grow things there and they can sell and earn for themselves. Think about that. What benefit they can get from the zakah in the form of cash, for example. Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Okay, sister, you had another question? Be more specific.
Like, we give them a small loan so that they can do a startup.
Not from zakah. This is qard hasan, huh? Where you give them a loan. A loan means they're going to pay it back.
Yeah,
but that is...
No interest.
No interest, but that's not zakah. That is a loan. I mean, that is what we call al-qard al-hasan. That is a kind loan. And you know, I love that idea, and as a matter of fact, I started a fund in Canada, very small, just within a small group. Because, you know, we had people within our community that couldn't afford their electricity bill. They just needed it, and you know, because they had a tough month or whatever, and they paid back. And, you know, the money would come back and go back to people who needed it. But this was a fund. It was known that this is for loans. Means we give it, and it comes back. So it's not zakah. You cannot use zakah for that. Sister in the back, you had a question? That is another excellent question, and I'm glad that it was asked. Again, one of those things that was in my mind. Okay, so everybody gets the picture? You have money with you, but you also owe. You have, say, 10,000 with you, and you have a 20,000 loan, as an example. But you know what? The loan you can pay back, I'm assuming it's interest-free, you can pay back within 10 years, right? So you're like, you know, they don't expect any more than 500 a month from me. You can't say 20,000 and I got 10, I'm actually in the hole 10,000. So actually, I'm eligible for zakah. You know, no, you can't say that. If you have that cash with you as savings, first of all, why didn't you use it to pay off the loan? As long as you have not done so, that means that this is excess cash. It's in your possession. You can do whatever you want with it. So you owe zakah on it. Okay? You owe zakah on it. Wallahu a'lam. Anything else? No.
Suppose you have a brother who had a stroke, so now he has no income. So can you? Is it better to pay, to give him the zakah as his monthly income rather than one lump sum?
Okay. What you can do is, let's say for example, a relative is now, had a stroke or whatever it may be, and as you say, you want to help them, you may open up. See, these things are really tricky because I've worked with people firsthand. Some people, to be very, very frank with you, are totally irresponsible when it comes to money. I mean, I've seen this in Canada firsthand. Somebody who is poor and who really needs that zakah to pay off a loan, for example. If you were to give that money in their hand, and that's an exception I mentioned just now, if you were to give it, they'll use that on something else. And the loan will remain. I've seen this firsthand. And therefore, my policy was, you bring me those papers, I know where the loan is due, I go and pay it on their behalf. Pay the loan on their behalf. This is allowed. Because this money is due to somebody else. Right? But it's on this person's shoulders. So you're doing it on their behalf. That is allowed. This is a little bit different. if the person is very irresponsible, if the person is very irresponsible, then insha'Allah ta'ala, there's no harm in doing that, but that money should be kept completely aside. And it should be made well known to those who are your heirs, for example, that this money, if I die, it is not for anybody to touch. If I'm going through a rough time, I cannot take from that money. It doesn't belong to me. It belongs to so-and-so. So it has to be put in their possession, if you will. You want to keep it with a guardian. You want to keep it with somebody who will then, you know, on that person's behalf pay, because they are irresponsible. Unfortunately, this is a reality, right? Insha'Allah, there is no harm in that. But other than that, maybe you can have an account for that person. Maybe you want to use it to pay their rent. Okay? You can pay the rent on their behalf for a whole year. Right? I mean, in some places you don't have an option. I was shocked because in Canada we pay monthly. When I went to Medina and I went to rent the house, the guy said, "Where's my rent?" "For the year." I said, "What?" And they take the rent for 1 year. So, you know, you can pay rent in advance for the year. Because that is a debt on that person, right? It is a debt. So when you pay the rent, I mean, this is something they owe already. So it's considered to be a debt on that individual. But again, it's tricky in that you have to make sure that person has possession of that wealth. Okay? If they're very irresponsible, then you act as their guardian. And you spend that wealth on them as is needed. But it is theirs. And you make it very clear. In your mind, you have to know also, you cannot touch that money for your own purposes in any way, shape, or form. This is zakah. That person is needy and is eligible to receive it. It is theirs. Ultimately, you know, if that is not the case and you're not sure, well then it's really their problem. You discharge your duty of giving them zakah. If they squandered it, that's really their problem. And, you know, you will not feel too inclined towards helping them after that, will you? So people do need to take these things into consideration. And that's why I said that we, along with helping people, and even when we're giving the zakah, we try to help people by advising them also, so they're not going to be careless on how they spend. Huh? Wallahu ta'ala a'lam. Anything else? Yes. It is up to you, as you see fit. In some cases, like I said, in some cases where it's, you know, where you can see that the benefit is in giving this person a lump sum. Because like I said, it makes them independent and they can thrive on their own afterwards. Wow, this is probably better in cases like that. And in other cases, you may say, well, you know, it's not not a small amount, it's not a huge amount, and there are people in need, and all of them or many of them are being neglected. At least spreading it out will be, there's a big benefit in it. To meet the needs, immediate needs of several people. Alhamdulillah, you may do that. That is up to you. But again, due diligence has to be done. We see where we are giving and where the optimum use can come, inshaAllah. Okay? Nah. Alaykum as-salam.
With regard to inheritance, the Prophet mentioned that when you own your death, you prepare wasiyah. I think that's a condition. In terms of wasiyah and fara'id, which is the preferred?
Okay, so we are now on another topic, and
you mentioned this earlier.
It's okay. I'm just kidding. This is another. This, by the way, subhanAllah, somebody was here from overseas, and he's left behind, I don't know how much, but a sum of money also for distribution amongst the poor and the needy. Alhamdulillah, as I said, the ummah is a giving ummah. This is somebody who was here on holiday, and he was speaking to somebody, and he said, "Do you know any needy people?" He said, "No, but I know somebody who does." And he mentioned me, and he said, "Okay, you go and give him that money to give to the poor and the needy." So this ummah is a generous ummah. This ummah is a giving ummah. Unfortunately, sometimes those who are responsible for distributing our charity don't do it the right way. But may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put more barakah in this ummah, so we will continue to give. And it doesn't matter. If we give and somebody squanders it, we've done our duty. Our reward is with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We'll just be smarter the next time as to where we give and how we give. Okay, coming back to what you said. First of all, that hadith, as with many, they sort of, you know, may misunderstand it. Doesn't mean that on your deathbed you need to make your, you know, you need to do your will. And wasiyah, what does that mean? When we talk about wasiyah in that sense, we're talking about remember how I said you only have authority to decide where up to a maximum of 1/3. وَثُلُثُ كَثِيرٌ. And some of them say, no, it should be less than 1/3. Because the Prophet ﷺ said, 1/3, and even 1/3 is too much. But up to a maximum of 1/3, you are free to say, we'll go here and there. Okay. So, before you die, if you want this to be done, then you should have that wasiyah made. In other words, I bequest that so much should go to this masjid, so much should go to that orphanage, to this relative of mine, to this friend of mine, and so forth. So this is the wasiyah we're talking about. As for the set proportions that your heirs will take from your property, you have no say in that. This is decided from above the seven heavens. So you cannot decide how much will go to this child or that child or this house to that child. No, you cannot do any of that. That's not in my... I don't have any authority over my own property. Allah has decided. Okay? So up to 1/3, you can say, I bequest it, the wasiyah, I bequest it to this or that cause or this or that individual who is not from your heirs. Is that clear? Wallahu ta'ala. Oh, they could be. Orphans, this... exactly. So orphans, some orphans are rich.
Yeah, I know, but my question is if they are in the orphanage. And so the orphanage gives zakah or zakat?
Okay. If you have orphans who are in those categories of being poor and needy, right? And I think what we're speaking of mainly are those types of orphans. Those who are wealthy, mashallah, they're not going to be in an orphanage, right? But those who are in an orphanage, and it's because they are poor and they're needy, they're dependent on somebody else. So, can we give zakat to them? Yes. And as I said, because they are young, and they are not responsible enough to know how to spend, you know, probably you give them some money, they're going to go to 7-Eleven. You know? I mean, not too wise to do that. So they have somebody who is a guardian over them. So we pay the zakat to them, and we say to them, this is what belongs to that orphan. Okay, so this is for the orphan, and I'm placing you in charge to spend on that individual. So it costs to maintain that individual, that orphan, it costs. Food costs, clothing costs. So they pay from that for the needs of that particular orphan. Okay, so yes, it is allowed. But like I said, again, we have to understand how it works. Tell them, no, I don't want you to use it to expand, for example, because it's a big project and want to expand. No, I want you to use it on those children for their basic needs. Allahu
a'lam. What about if some ulama going around collecting contribution to building of like Kafi school, Islamic school?
Sadaqah, that we give sadaqah for. No. No. For that, you give from the sadaqah. Sadaqah is what we call our free wealth. Whereas zakah is an obligation. That's why I'm saying we need to be really careful. Some of them, you know, they broadened it a little bit too much. But we say no, especially in a country like this, alhamdulillah, Muslim country, there's a lot of good that goes around. And we give our sadaqah from our free wealth in order for them to establish these schools and these, you know, madaris and whatever else. Okay? Allahu a'lam. So don't give them from sadaqah, give them from zakah, give them from sadaqah, and zakah, use it for... I mean, maybe you want to sponsor a child though, poor child, right? To sponsor that child in that madrasa or that tahfiz school, maybe, yes, that is possible. Okay? And again, we just have to make sure we do due diligence. It costs money to support that child. That child cannot afford an education, needs an education. Alhamdulillah, you've collected sadaqah and you've built the school, now you need money in order to support that child. So you can spend on the needs of that child. Maybe, you know, because it is a religious school, and let's tell the truth, very often the teachers are underpaid, very much underpaid. It's not even enough for them to make ends meet. So the zakah can be used to top up for those teachers, for example. Not salary. Salary is separate, and zakah will be given over and above to help them cover their needs because their salary was not enough. Wallahu a'lam. Okay? Subhanakallahumma bihamdika ashhadu an la ilaha illa anta.